Welcome back to Radio Rothbard. I'm Ryan McMaken. I'm a senior editor with the Mises Institute. And with me, as usual, is Tho Bishop, my associate editor. And for this week, I had wanted to talk about some general issues of good news that we could celebrate. News that generally was going to be things like how many people finally figured out that the FBI is not your friend, that that conservatives are finally getting a clue about how the U.S. military is not the great pillar of American society that they think it is, and just a variety of ways that finally a lot of people who have long claimed to be in favor of freedom but have always backed the regime in its various institutions are finally figuring out that they were way too sympathetic toward the U.S. government in the past, and that maybe they should reconsider their support. Because, of course, we used to run articles that were highly critical of the regime, and the comment section would fill up with a bunch of conservatives, self-identifying conservatives, who would talk about how, you know, what bad guys we were for calling into question the great, glorious American history and all of that. And a lot of people seem to be moving beyond that. But rather than kind of taking a real broad view of that and looking at specific issues, I came across a real fun article that looks at this issue for us and provides actually some great analysis. This is an article that is by a writer named Joshua Tate. And it appeared in a publication called The Bulwark, which you've probably come across if you just read these sorts of things. And it's called The Problem with Right-Wing Regime Talk, with regime in quotes. And the basic idea here is that right-wingers now using the word regime. And this is a cause for alarm. And why are they suddenly using this word? And he calls it the new paranoid buzzword. Says, well, what this reveals about the new right. So I'll just kind of give you a couple of quotes. His evidence here is that the word is being used a lot more now in certain conservative publications, like the Federalist, like the American Conservative, and so on. But it seemed to have really picked up after the whole Mar-a-Lago raid thing. And so he looks at a couple of headlines. One at the American Conservative was called "The Regime Wants Its Revenge." And then another one was at the Federalist, and it used phrases like "the regime made Trump a martyr," and and then of course the usual suspects like the people at InfoWars and stuff were using that term. But I think what's remarkable is that people like Ron DeSantis and people at the Federalist and people at the American Conservative are now using the term "the regime" to describe the U.S. government. And Tate basically says that what's the real problem with that? And I think if you paid attention to how the word regime has been traditionally used in the past, you can see how it's a real change in tone. So if you follow international relations and how the media addresses these issues, you know that the word regime is only used to refer to governments we don't like. So whoever's in charge of the United Kingdom, we don't refer to the British regime or the regime of the United Kingdom. That's not done in the New York Times. You only refer to the regime if it's the government of a place that the CIA has told us we don't like. So Venezuela, Iran, Iraq, the axis of evil countries, whoever George Bush decided to topple, you know, in any given week in 2004, that's a regime. But we don't use that term when we like the government. So the fact that the right wing has now started to use the term to refer to the U.S. government alarms a lot of sort of these mainstream, typical Atlantic, Vox, the Bulwark type journalists. And so I find that to be a very, very interesting development. And, you know, I'll just check in with you, though. I mean, is this a good reading? Is this, have you been noticing this term? Because I don't really hang out with these people, so I don't I don't know. Is the use of the term like really up? Is it a new thing? Has its usage really increased?
Well, again, the fact that you have again people like Ron DeSantis using it, you know, who is in many ways the ideological leader of the Republican Party, if not the spiritual one. I think this, you know, Donald Trump still kind of has his place there, but you know, this is not a Ron's not kind of like a Blake Masters or J.D. Vance, kind of one of the up and coming sort of Peter Thiel aligned sort of guys. I mean, here you have again the guy that's the figurehead of what conservatism is from a policy standpoint, really in the country right now, embracing this us versus them mentality of kind of this illegitimate authoritarian deep state, and this is kind of trending up from the rhetoric of Trump's 2016 campaign, right? You know, drain the swamp. Steve Bannon, right, really popularizing the concept of the deep state, the administrative state, kind of using his position with, you know, previously Breitbart, now War Room, which I think is the closest thing you have right now to Rush Limbaugh's radio show. Not quite the same audience, a different platform, but it's the same sort of thing where people, you know, I talked to Republicans up here in Panhandle. Like they watch Steve Bannon's show every single morning because like that's kind of their kind of sense of like marching orders into how to engage with the news cycle, with the ideas of the day. And all of this really is kind of percolating through. And we mentioned this article in the Bulwark. The Bulwark, it's worth pointing out, right? This is kind of the modern day National Review Weekly Standard type, right? This was the breakaway of the Bill Kristol world from kind of the dinosaurs of conservative media, and they kind of see themselves as being the attack dogs, kind of from, you know, from that neoconservative hit, you know, past, kind of attacking, you know, what they will call the new right. But it's not alone. There's a series of articles that, again, these all come from a antagonistic perspective, right? They are detailing what is going on in modern conservative circles, you know, in a sense of outrage and disgust. But I think they do a great job of capturing what is actually going on here. One of the articles they link is a Vanity Fair article, Inside the New Right, where Peter Thiel is placing his biggest bets, which kind of details one of the last year's National Conservative Conference, which is one of the kind of the uprising events where you deal with some of these sort of this intellectual side of the right. There's also a very fun article titled The Violent Fantasies of Blake Masters that was published in the New York Times last month as well. And again, all these kind of outline some common characteristics. You know, they talk about the work of Curtis Yarvin and some of these and some of the philosophers that have influenced him. You know, people like Sam Francis, people like James Burnham, Paul Gottfried would kind of be mixed into that group. You know, so the paleoconservative, paleo-libertarian crowd, which obviously had crossover with Murray Rothbard in the 90s. You know, you mentioned Lew Rockwell's use of the American regime. It's worth noting, and this is one of my favorite trivia points of the 2020 election cycle, Blake Masters literally was writing anti-war articles for lewrockwell.com back in 2006. And so, you know, if we want to look at where are, you know, can we actually see concrete examples of parts of our intellectual sphere percolating within this discontent of the modern right? Blake Masters is, I think, a very clear example. Peter Thiel, who is one of the big funders of this kind of broader network, and he's obviously very familiar with Austro-libertarian ideas. You know, there is something interesting going on. And again, their concerns that they have are I love to see it. And the more that we see people like Ron DeSantis kind of echoing this, I take that as good news.
Well, of course, they use the same language that the National Review's type of crowd has long used, which is that we are the reasonable conservatives. And all the other people who disagree with us are paranoid, crazy people. And so the use of the word paranoid here was very interesting. And if you follow the whole history of the conservative movement and all of that, anytime you see the word paranoid, that should immediately make you think of Richard Hofstadter's 1964 article, The Paranoid Style in American Politics. And he wrote probably the most influential article that ever ran in Harper's was this article. And it's been repeated, especially by commentary, by guys at Commentary, by guys at National Review. William F. Buckley, right, used the strategy, is that those populist types, they're all paranoid crazies, and so come join us, because we support the Vietnam War, we support the U.S. government, we're patriots, and all those people who oppose the government are horrible, horrible people. And that was standard mainstream conservative thought throughout the late 60s into the 70s and 80s, and really only started to unravel after the Cold War came to an end. And so I recognized that immediately. He's clearly playing on those same sorts of ideas that were forwarded back in the 60s to tarnish anyone who voted for Barry Goldwater as being paranoid. And then, of course, it folds new ideas in here, Tate does, in the Bulwark article, by implying that anyone who uses the word regime to oppose, what do you want to call it, the deep state, the establishment, as we used to call it, the elite, the Washington, the swamp, whatever, that those people, quote unquote, oppose our democracy. This is the new, I think, buzzword, right? And when people say support democracy, what they really mean, that's just a euphemism for support the status quo, support the current ruling class. That's what support our democracy means. Because you'll notice this, basically, opposition to those things is always labeled as anti-democratic, as being a threat to our democracy. And there's very close overlap there. And so you want to be tarnished as being against democracy, just criticize the ruling class. That's all it takes, because these are one and the same then. And so the general premise here is that, yes, the people are now using the term in the way that you would use it to refer to illegitimate regimes in the foreign world. And then what does that mean? And Tate's point is that you use the word to indicate a government you would like to topple, basically. And because he says here, why do we use the term for these governments we don't like? Because we all support essentially regime change. And he says, what do people ultimately do to regimes? They topple them. And I think that's a really good insight. And as I was reading Tate's article, I was like, hey, this is a really insightful article. This is filled with really good points. The only thing I would change it is the general tone and the panic that's contained in the article. For the most part, the analysis is really quite good, as you note, right? Pointing out people like Sam Francis's analysis, who had this idea, right, that these middle American conservatives would become very suspicious and afraid of the U.S. regime and would become radicals in opposition to it. Now, I never really liked Francis, not because of his foreign policy, for sure. That was the best part about him. And he did have some very insightful stuff. I think it was maybe just more his tone. His tone was really like sad, angry old man. And, you know, that's like the opposite of Rothbard, which was more always rollicking, we're gonna win, you know, the sweep of history is on our side sort of thing. Francis wasn't like that at all, at least in when I would read him. But a lot of the conclusions were very, very similar. And so just to see, is this article even right about, is it being used? And, you know, I wanted your kind of on-the-ground assessment. I went in and I looked at just... I used Google to look at, where's the phrase, the regime, used at places like the American Conservative or the Federalist in this way in the past. And it turns out it wasn't, really. If you exclude the last couple of years, you find that the term regime is used only in the more traditional right-wing way, which is to refer to governments we don't like and have targeted for regime change and are run by very bad men and all of that stuff. And that only changed in the last couple of years. But anytime I see the word and I saw that this was supposedly a new thing, I was reminded of the fact that Lew Rockwell, routinely used the term in the past. And I wanted to look for some great examples of that. And I was able to find some great old stuff where Lou basically was using it in the proper way. And I found an old 2013 interview, for example, and this was back before I worked for the Mises Institute or was really involved in any sort of formal role in any of that stuff. But Lou and I did a podcast, and I had asked him in 2013 about the issue of legitimacy and how does the regime perpetuate its legitimacy? How does it get people to like it and so on? And Lou says, in response to the need for legitimacy, because we were talking, I think, about Etienne de la Boetie, who talked about how it doesn't matter how repressive your regime is. Once people just cease to believe that it has any legitimacy, the regime falls, which of course happened in the Soviet Union. But Lou says, quote, "This is why, for example, the government spends so much time trying to get everybody to vote. It's why the public schools tend to spend so much time getting you to agree to the legitimacy of the regime, because they require the consent of the people. The parasites must necessarily be much smaller than the host, so or they can't live it up like they do, and they can't run their wars and do all the rest. So they're always a tiny minority, democracy disguised as this. One of the reasons they love democracy. But still, the facts of the situation are most of us are not beneficiaries of the regime. We're the victims of the regime," unquote. Probably a great summary of Rothbard's view of the regime, of the exploitation that occurs under the aegis of the ruling class, both nationally and internationally, by the way, Rothbard would often point out, is that the U.S. regime doesn't reserve its exploitation to just Americans and American taxpayers. But this also reflects a lot of his work, and he frequently mentions the regime back in his 2003 book, Speaking of Liberty. And he says basically what our goal is that as long as public opinion generally supports a regime so that the system is more friends than enemies, it survives. But when the situation reverses so that the regime has more enemies than friends, the path of history can turn dramatically. The regime must either conform to the turning of the tide or risk its very existence. This is Lou back in 2002, I believe, is when that actual talk was written. So you can see the view right here is very important because it's looking at the regime as something other than we the people. And I think that's been the very important development that's happened recently. I can't tell you how many emails I got over the years of just how we'll defeat the bad guys once people realize that the proper role of the federal government is to serve we the people, which it has never, ever done. Right. That was just propaganda there in the preface of the U.S. Constitution. Right. George Washington, the richest man in America, was not we the people. He rode out on horseback to kill the Whiskey Rebellion people, hated the whole. I don't know. Obviously, hate him. Lots of people hated him, but was in mortal fear of the Shays Rebellion type people. Those were the we the people. The Whiskey Rebellion guys were we the people. George Washington was against we the people, as the federal government has always been. And the Jeffersonians always tried to mitigate that. And so the fact that they're just finally, the right-wing mainstream is starting to finally start to refer to it as the regime, as something separate from the U.S. people, is a fairly new development in the fact that it seems to be becoming more common and beyond just a very small number on the right. And if that is true, if that really grows and they finally start to internalize this idea that the people who run the U.S. government are opposed to the interests of the vast majority of Americans, then some actual headway might be finally made.
And again, there is this dynamic where the people that talk the most about, you know, the sort of managerial revolution, right? It's still sort of online right-wing Twitter circles and podcasts, right? This sort of, you know, the popular intellectuals of this kind of new right environment, you know, people that write for Chronicles or Claremont or some of these, you know, institutions that have made themselves the platforms for the more intellectual side of Trumpism broadly, many of which I have great respect for. And I think there's a lot of interesting overlap there. the question then is how do these things trickle out from these sort of intellectual circles into the rank and file Republican voter? And that's where the biggest asset here is, we've talked about in recent episodes, right? The Biden regime's response to Trump himself personally, that itself kind of puts on full display on every Fox News television, right? The idea that if they can march FBI agents into Mar-a-Lago, what will stop them from doing it to us? The persecution of January 6th activists for, being upset about an issue that the majority of Republicans believe, was an illegitimate election. There are things that the clunkiness and the heavy-handedness of these members of the regime, right, of the deep state, of the administrative state, that backlash to the populist moment has made normal Republicans that care about the news cycle, which I don't want, which is an important aspect there. There's plenty of voters that do not pay attention really to the news cycle that much, right? That they just want to grill, whatever. They might not be quite as motivated by this sort of sense right now, but the your average Fox News voter, again, the fact that we've gone from Bill O'Reilly to Tucker Carlson in the course of a decade, that's where the mass popularizing of this distrust of DC is so important. Again, you will find random spontaneous people now protesting the local FBI office here in my community with defund the FBI, precisely because they recognize it as a threat in their own backyard that risks their own life and liberty. And so this concept of this alienation of, the concept of America kind of in your heart and the government that rules it, I think is very much grounded into the way that conservatives view modern politics. And the overlap within the intellectual right here is something I do find very interesting. Again, it's very reminiscent of the paleo-libertarian 90s sort of days. And one of the reasons I think, again, with the same, again, not a broad endorsement for Sam Francis' views broadly, but one of the things that's really interesting reading sort of his histories of American politics, like the kind of the American conservative movement, when you connect it with Rothbard, is that Francis was writing kind of as a fellow traveler, right? He was writing as a conservative, optimistic about Goldwater, optimistic about Reagan, this entire concept like Caesarism, which has kind of become popular, became popular with the Trump days. That was originally talking about Reagan, the idea that Reagan was going to come in and be the conservative Caesar and be the embodiment of this growing decades-long conservative movement of, all of it kind of going back to the response to the FDR days, right? And that we're going to overthrow this massive centralization growth of the welfare warfare state. Obviously, that did not happen. Reagan just kind of, Reagan brought in Bush as his VP. Reagan convinced these conservatives that spent decades kind of frothing at a distrust of DC and basically convinced them that DC is not their enemy, but something they can work with. This is Francis's entire critique of Reagan and the conservative movement after this happens, is that conservatives refuse to recognize that the government itself had become inherently structured against their own interests, right? They were meant to serve that progressive intellectual class and depended upon subsidizing a broader, poorer class with welfare payments and things like that to give them legitimacy and power within the state. And that trying to work with these people, trying to work with these federal bureaucracies is complete. It's the belief that persuasion really is what governs a country rather than actual coalitions and power. And it turns out that didn't work. And I think this very much goes well aligned with Rothbard, who his political histories of this entire era are very different, right? Because he left the conservatives after Taft's defeat to Eisenhower. He joins the New Left for a while. He becomes builds the American political libertarian movement. He's promoting anarcho-capitalism and things like that. They are parallel in their navigating these environments, right? You know, Goldwater, famously, you know, Rothbard was anti-Goldwater. And yet they come together within the early 90s. And because there's a lot of commonality between Francis's critiques of, you know, using the Burnham sense, this managerial late, and Rothbard's appreciation for like the power of throne and altar, right? His view of the progressive era as a centralizing force, as the fulfillment of this intellectual class. And so it's very interesting how these very distinct strains of thought complement each other very well. Obviously, the biggest issue that Francis has, paleoconservatives always had, and that, you know, the new right, I think, still has, is lacking the economic lens of Rothbard. If Francis focuses a lot more on sort of the real politic of economics, and so, like, you know, oh, well, in order to overthrow the managerial class, we need economic policies that are going to enrich these sort of middle American radicals, right? So we need economic policies that reward, you know, working class patriots. We need to have policies that will benefit small business owners. He even talks about like the rise of the Sun Belt sort of industries, which are kind of like military defense companies and things like that, as a way of kind of checking Wall Street and their interests, right? The kind of the war must feed the war sort of mentality. Of course, I think, you know, Rothbard's economic analysis is so important here. Kind of just, it grounds it back to really the main power driver of this entire managerial revolution, right? Which is the Federal Reserve. It is the state's monopolization of money creation. It is from that mechanism that they are able to fund, you know, an insane higher education system, an insane warfare state, an insane welfare state. And so if the right doesn't grasp, I think, that important Austrian insight, right, of just how important the money issue, the credit expansion issue is to funding all of the things that they critique of, I think, properly, of the modern American state. There's going to be issues there, right? You're going to end up embracing some sort of form of economic, you know, being economically left but culturally conservative type, which kind of has become very popular within some of these new right, Francis favoring circles. But of course, if you're promoting economic recklessness, you're not going to end up fortifying anything culturally. And all you're going to do is end up helping fund and further empower the very regime that you claim to oppose. Because the idea, like, oh, we're just going to come in, we're going to clear out all the offices, we're going to stack them full of our own people, and everything's going to be hunky-dory. Like, that's, I think that is where this new right acts very much kind of in this wish fulfillment style of political strategy. We need to be very sober in our understanding of all of these very various institutions of power if we want to be able to tear them down. And so again, that's where I think there is still there's still a necessity for that sort of a John Randolph society interminglings, because I do think there's some value here within the ways the new right views politics, views power, and the way that it is popular, being popularized amongst the masses. But it is no substitute for true, you know, a proper understanding of economics. And that's where I think that the Jacksonian era provides so much value, in the way that Jacksonians were able to popularize economics in a way to make it relevant to those that care about the spiritual well-being of a country, the moral well-being of a country, the anti-corruption cronyism within, you know, kind of good governance sort of you know, focus, right? And so that's where there still needs to be inroads with the sort of people that this Bulwark and other articles are critiquing here.
Yeah, the Jeffersonians were much more effective on this at really getting to the heart of the state. And it's definitely progress then that you've got conservatives referring to the regime. But as you say, the economic side of things illustrates the other big blind spot. Now, if you look at the history of state building, states, they do two things. Two things are absolutely key to state building. One is to build a powerful military apparatus. And two, take control of the financial sector. These are absolutely the most essential things that states do when they try to build themselves up. So if you, as a political movement, claim to be opposed to the regime, but you ignore the financial sector or at least fail to understand it and really to address those issues, as well as the military, or actively support these things, actively support Wall Street, actively support the military, and then say, well, you know, I'm against too much government power. That's swell, but you're basically missing the point. You don't understand how states build up their power and the most key state institutions that exist. I mean, complaining about the Social Security system, this is like a minor player in how state building works. Now, in the U.S., the Social Security has been extremely helpful in the sense that it makes people dependent on the federal government rather than on more local institutions. And so I'm just embarrassed for them every time I see old conservatives trying to... This was a big problem with the Tea Party, right? Is don't spend any more money on those poor people, but keep my Medicare money coming. Keep my Social Security money coming. I want my federal check. Keep my federal money coming. And so there was this inability to break away from a dependency on the federal government, not to mention the millions of conservatives who were on federal pensions because they had worked in various federal jobs. And so this refusal to believe that this institution was inherently problematic, it's just they were spending too much money on certain groups we didn't like. So that's just a failing strategy. Right there. And so I think you are starting to see moves beyond it. But yeah, the economic side of it is so key. If you don't understand the role of the central bank, you don't understand the role of how the state controls the financial sector and the economy in general, you've got a huge blind spot there that's going to fail. And you continue to see issues just recently where you had the American Conservative was running an article supporting a federal program for paid family leave. And so just yet again, let's look to the federal government to solve our family problems. And boy, that is a horrible miscalculation. And so maybe they're starting to figure out that's a terrible idea. But yeah, the economy aspect of it is so essential. But part of what Francis was good on, though, was that recognizing that American politics is about conflict, right? And this is something the Jeffersonians and Jacksonians always recognized, is that we're not all in it together. It's democracy. American democracy is not this thing where we all get together and get along and agree on something. First of all, Americans in the 19th century were not nearly as naive about this just in general, right? They recognize that elections have consequences, that when one side has power, they use that power to hurt the other side. And the idea that that wasn't the case is a 20th century invention and something that I think a lot of naive conservatives really bought into that idea that we can't all get along. When you have a big, powerful government, you can't all get along. Policy changes have winners and losers. And so a lot of this analysis then you do get, I mean, there's really nothing novel in Curtis Yarvin, right, in recognizing the role that oligarchic power plays in regimes and all of that stuff. A lot, that's all in this political science literature already. However, popularizing it for a certain audience and recognizing that the nature of politics is conflict, and it's nasty conflict. It's people using the power of the state to screw over the other guy. That's the nature of it. That it's very good that people are starting to recognize that. And the history of the U.S. is about conflict. It's about certain groups using the power of the state to hurt other groups, whether based on economic lines, racial lines, where your grandfather came from, what region of the country are you in? Are you a farmer? Are you a city dweller? This has always been a huge aspect of American politics. And while Pat Buchanan does a lot of good work, he's often flogged the silly idea that America used to be united and everybody got along and now things are bad because we don't all get along. That's a weird fairy tale. I don't know why some people stick to that. But people are finally maturing, I think, in this and recognizing maybe what more sophisticated leftists have long recognized is that, look, we're here to take control. We're here to seize power and then use it to our advantage. And I think maybe that's one of the main upsides of people finally starting to view the regime as the regime.
Well, of course, and this is where like revisionist history is so important, right? Because there is the reason why conservatives have had this always very romantic portrayal of the American government as, oh, well, you know, I may not like the president right now. I may disagree with this policy. I may want my taxes to be lower. It's like, oh, but you know, at least we have, you know, not a democracy, but a republic. You know, we're the freest country in the world. You know, we have, you know, one man, one voice, of the people, by the people, yada yada yada. And of course, this was never really true, right? You know, from the very get-go, the American political system was shaped by corruption and self-interest, right? It was shaped by cronyism, as Patrick Newman's great book on this era highlights, right? You know, the idea that, oh, well, we just have these very wise men gather into legislative bodies and they debate with persuasion and reason. And ultimately, that's going to end up with a result that's going to create great outcomes for us all because they just have our best interests at heart. You know, I think that there is a level of that where it might work in certain sort of a very high trust, you know, tribal societies where you really have communities, you know, where you really do have kind of your natural elite, right, that really have a longer vision and can you know, make sort of big scale decisions. But in a country as large as the U.S., even back when it was, you know, 13 states, much less now with over 330 million people, you know, that system just doesn't work. It's something where they are able to extrapolate, or whether to extract the wealth of the nation as a whole and reward it out to show, you know, who the give out spoils to whatever political faction is surviving right now. And I think it's very telling. You know, there's a great Twitter account out there, Aaron McIntyre. You know, he keeps has like this running gag where you know, every time there's some sort of outrageous financial, you know, some new arms package to Ukraine or some sort of big giveaway to some sort of leftist special interest group, you know, he just you know, quote tweets it and says, you know, we're now at the point of the timeline where they're racking the sacking the treasury for their own interests. That's kind of where I think there's that sense right now when people think about modern America, you know, it is this complete defeat that, you know, it's all the sense of pretense has dropped, right? The mask has dropped. You have both sides that completely hate each other. I mean, first day after winning the primary, Charlie Crist is out there saying that everyone that supports Ron DeSantis has hate in their hearts and that he doesn't want their support. It's like there is no even pretense now of this old school fairy tale that, you know, golly gosh darn, you know, we may have different political views, but we come together and we make decisions together because, you know, united we stand, right? We've all lost the pretense of it, and that reframes politics back to this power dynamic. And hopefully it's not just simply one side that gets it. You know, you look at like the student bailout, the student loan bailout, you know, that's clearly the governing party rewarding a demographic that disproportionately votes in their favor, right? That is them rewarding their loyal members of their tribe. You know, Republicans typically aren't quite good at doing that, right? They don't take care really of their interest groups, right? You know, they take care of big corporations that are increasingly woke, but they don't really take care to a great extent the sort of people that vote Republican on a regular basis. And so it's going to be interesting to see, is this skepticism of DC, is this regime narrative, can it actually be translated into changing the operational structure of the Republican Party? Or is the Republican Party going to continue to be governed and led by the Mitch McConnells and the Kevin McCarthys of the world? And instead, all of this is going to kind of be the talk of kind of the edgy online circles of the modern right that never really translates it into political action. That's the big open question mark. Again, that's why, you know, seeing people like Blake Masters, seeing people like, I'm less excited about J.D. Vance than Blake Masters, but these sort of Peter Thiel aligned, Curtis Yarvin, connected sort of figures, seeing them translate into actual office holders. And then the impact that has on the party as a whole is going to be very interesting in the next few years.
Well, and of course, I want to stick up for the Rothbardian view here too, and just note that, as Rothbard always recommended, noting what is your ultimate goal, right? As opposed to what is an intermediate goal. Right. Obviously, these are all good intermediate developments. Right. People finally figuring out that the regime is not on their side, that maybe significant reaction has to be taken to really start to rein in the power of the U.S. state and stop treating it like it's synonymous with we the people. And I was thinking of this because I have a couple of readers who just send occasionally nice questions and suggestions. Sometimes some people send 3,000 word rants in response to a 1,000 word article. But one of the readers named Stephen, he said, what is the difference between state and regime? And that's an excellent question. I don't think they are the same. And certainly if you were to look at the way that historians of the state use the term, it's not the same thing. But I would say, what's the difference then between a Rothbardian and a good new style of Trump conservative here? I would say that perhaps the distinction is that the new populist conservatives, they're finally coming around to the idea that the regime is a problem and something has to be done about it to get rid of it. But that the advanced Rothbardian, the enlightened level, the champion level Ron Paul type recognizes that it's not enough to just get rid of the regime. The state itself is a problem. And once you get to the point of recognizing that the regime is something that you need to oppose, keep going. Don't stop there. Keep going all the way to opposing the state. Now, that may not be practical at any given time, but that's the goal you have to keep in mind. And you're like, well, what does that mean? What's the difference between the regime and the state? Well, you can have a change in the regime. You can abolish a certain regime without abolishing the state, right? States have regimes come and go. Although there is some degree of permanence usually with a regime, the state is much, much more permanent and has been around for 400 years, 350, and really only 200 in most of the world or less. But the state is that whole apparatus, right? And it's also something that exists in your head. The state can't exist without a certain frame of mind, right? And many Americans, even those who oppose the regime, are still in that line of thinking that we need a national government to keep us all together, that we need this one society that we all come together, that even if we get rid of a regime we don't like, that we're still America, that we're still this one thing, that we need some sort of coercive force to unite us all behind. And that's the idea then of the state that really drives the support for the regimes, because almost everybody in the world now thinks that states are necessary, that states are good, that their national state is wonderful. And I think even if you polled most of these people who are now souring on the regime, they would say, well, of course, there should be one America. You will get like a certain growing minority of people who think that it should be split up. But there's still an immense amount of sympathy for the idea of an American state, or maybe just two American states. But the idea of an organization with a monopoly on coercion that bosses everybody around, that taxes everybody, that tells everybody how to live. I don't think most people have progressed to the point of disliking the idea of that sort of organization, so long as that organization supports my particular way of life. And so when Rothbard talks about opposing the state, when Rockwell talks about opposing the state, they're talking about something much bigger than just opposing the current regime. That's a discussion perhaps for another day, but that I just want to get in there that from the Rockwell Rothbard point, hardcore libertarian point of view, it's not enough to just oppose the current regime. The current regime has its lifeblood because most people still support the state. And so make a distinction there. It's important to see that these aren't the same things, and that if you just oppose the idea of the regime, you're not radical enough. You need to keep going. But baby steps for everybody. That's fine. I congratulate the people who are just opposing the regime at this point. That's fine. That's good.
Right. Yeah. Particularly given exactly what America has become. You know, all governments are bad. Some governments are less bad than others. And getting rid of the current standing order. I think we'll probably end up with something marginally less worse than what we have right now.
Well, in fact, I even look back at Rothbard's whole, right, his article on the populist agenda. And of course, so much of it's just like, get rid of the ATF, get rid of the FBI, get rid of all of these organizations that are really just new in the second half of the 20th century for the most part. But one funny thing I noticed, he's often criticized for saying, you know, let the police clean up the streets. I noticed for the first time that he says, let the police clean up the streets so long as they are still held liable when they are in error.
It's which, a bold stand against immunity.
Right. I thought, whoa, well, okay. Well, he just lost his support among most supporters of the police right there because he wants them to actually be liable for mistakes. So people don't generally mention that when they talk about how Rothbard was some sort of unconditional supporter of police. No, he wanted to get rid of qualified immunity, obviously, apparently. But for the most part, Rothbard clearly was fine with, hey, just do these five things and you've vastly improved the nature of the regime. But of course, you know, he didn't change his overall end game, which was to massively weaken the state overall. But he'll take some in-between positions when necessary.
And if we want to go back to good news about all those points there, sounds like the campaign platform for Marjorie Taylor Greene. So we are making progress.
Well, maybe Rothbard was right. Maybe we actually are winning. It is important to keep in mind, though, that what Rothbard's scope of history in his mind, because, of course, he read extensively in history, so was probably at least 200 years. So he's looking at events from the 19th century as really the indication of where we should look to the future now. So, yeah, so if you think that this new recent rightward term in terms of using words like regime and delegitimizing the state and stuff is going to lead to massive changes next year. Probably going to be waiting a little bit longer than that. But that doesn't mean that there's not some good trends out there that we can celebrate. So, we'll go ahead and wrap up with that for this episode of Radio Rothbard. Thank you for listening, and we'll be back next week with another episode, and we'll see you next time.